Continuing from the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our last class, walillahi ta'ala alhamd, we reached Ghazwa al-Badr al-Kubra, the great battle of Badr. And this was the first victory for the Muslims. Now, in order for us to understand why this battle took place and how this battle took place, there was some introductions to events concerning that battle, specifically that battle and generally the struggles and the battles of the Anbiya, the Prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the things we did in the previous classes we mentioned is that sunan Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's laws in his creation, universal law, they never ever ever change. And when the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sunnah to tadafur, the sunnah of repentance, that the struggle between the truth and the falsehood is a continuous struggle. So in order to keep the evil in check, it has to be repelled by what? By the good, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضُهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not check or repel one set of people with another set of people, the whole earth would become what? Corrupted. So based on this sunnah to tadafur, based on this repellence, many battles they took place even before the battle of Badr. And the mushrikeen, because of their sirah, they struggle against the truth, even though the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had left Mecca. A majority of the companions, they left Mecca and made hijrah to Medina. They did not stop in their cave, their planning, their plotting, and trying to attack the Muslims in many different ways. So one of the things we covered previously was, one of the first things they did was to make a declaration of war. That anybody from the people of Medina, even from the nobles of the people of Medina, is considered to be an enemy from an enemy state and is no longer safe. Anyone, be it Muslim or non-Muslim, they made the first declaration of war, not the Muslims. And we mentioned an incident concerning one of the nobles of Medina, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. And what did we mention concerning Sa'd ibn Mu'adh? That he was from the nobles of the people of Medina. And in Jahiliyyah, in him and Umayyah ibn Khalaf, they were friends. And even in Islam. So every time Umayyah would go to Medina, it would be hosted by Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. And any time Sa'd ibn Mu'adh go to Mecca, it would be hosted by Umayyah ibn Khalaf. So after accepting Islam, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh went to Mecca and was hosted by Umayyah ibn Khalaf. And they bumped into the Fir'aun of this Ummah, Abu Jahl. And Abu Jahl, he saw Umayyah ibn Khalaf with Sa'd ibn Mu'adh from the people of Medina. And Abu Jahl, he knows who Sa'd is. But he asked Umayyah ibn Khalaf, man had, who is this? He says, Sa'd. He said, this is Sa'd. He knew who he was. So Abu Jahl, he said to him, da ala araka tatufu bi Makkah aminan wa qad awaytum suba'a. That I can't believe I could see you wandering around Makkah in a state of security, and you have protected those who've left their religion. وَتُعِينُهُمْ, and you're aiding them. وَاللَّهِ لَوْلَا أَنَّكَ مَعَ أَبِي صَفْوَانَ مَا رَجَعْتَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِكَ سَالِمًا. If it wasn't for the fact you've Abu Safwan, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, you would not have gone back to your family alive. That's the only thing saving you. So this was a declaration of war, that nobody from the people of Medina to come into Mecca no longer except with a security contract or guarantee of security. So then, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, he raised his voice. He said, if you prevent me from making or going around Mecca, لَأَمْنَعَنَّكَ مِمَّا هُوَ أَشَدْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. I'll prevent you from something even greater than this. Meaning, your trade which passes through the route of Medina, I'll stop it passing through Medina. So they continued to make this declaration of war, and they continued with the mushrikeen, the polytheists of Medina, encouraging them and urging them to attack the Muslims in where? In Medina. So the mushrikeen of Mecca, they wrote a letter to the mushrikeen of Medina, and in that letter they said to them that innakum awaytum sahibana, you're giving refuge to our companion, meaning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The mushrikeen said this, وَإِنَّا لَنُقْسِمُ بِاللَّهِ, and we swear to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're going to fight him, we're going to kill him, وَلَنُخْرِجَنَّهُ, and we're going to expel him from Medina. Jayid? And we're going to come to you in our full capacity of all our forces. Hatta naqtul. And not only we're going to kill Muhammad and expel him, we're going to kill all of your army. So they're not only threatening the Muslim, but even the mushrikeen of Medina. It's an enemy state now. We're going to kill your army. We're going to take your women. The Muslims and the non-Muslims. When that reached Abdullah ibn Ubay and those with him from the mushrikeen, they went to attack the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you have to leave. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to them, Dad, are you going to fight against me and your own people, meaning the Muslims from the Muhajirin, for the sake of the Quraysh? Then they turned back. So the mushrikeen, they continue with this plotting. So before the Battle of Badr, we mentioned there was many ghazawat and many saraya. And we said there's a difference between ghazwa and sariya. And what are the difference between these two? Who could remember? What's the difference between a ghazwa and sariya? What's the difference between the two? MashaAllah. Jazakallah khair. A ghazwa is when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took part in the battle. So any battle where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there is a ghazwa. And the number could be much or little, and they may be fighting, no fighting. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be in attendance. And what's the sariya? Barakallah khair. He wasn't there. He would send people. And usually the numbers were small. They may be fighting or fighting, or simply it could just be for reconnaissance. So there were many, there were six I think we covered all together. And the last battle before Ghazwatul Badr was what battle? The last battle before Badr, Ghazwa, was which battle? That's not Sariya. Ghazwa. What was the last Ghazwa before Ghazwa al-Badr? The last battle before the Battle of Badr. No. Ghazwatul Badr. The last battle was Ghazwatul Badr. Meaning Ghazwatul Badr al-Ula, the first battle of Badr. Or As-Sughra, the minor battle of Badr. And what was the purpose behind this battle of Badr? What did we say last week? Why did they have this battle of Badr? What was the purpose behind this battle? The purpose behind the battle was the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew that the Quraysh, they had a wihlatan, they had two tricks. في الصيف وفي الشتاء as Allah Ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Quraysh إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشِّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ. They had two trips, one in the summer and one in the winter. The one in the summer towards where? Asham, Syria, Jordan. And the one in the winter towards where? Yemen. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was summer, he knew they'll be heading with their trade caravans to where? To Asham. So he laid in ambush and wanted to attack their caravans. Why would the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam attack the caravans and take the wealth of the mushrikeen? Why? And this is a very important question that needs answering, so we understand the context behind this. The reason the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was doing this, not because he didn't stick to his covenant, not because he wanted to just rob them for the sake of robbing them, but rather, the muhajireen, those who migrated from Mecca to Medina, their wealth were forcibly taken from them. Such as Suhaim radiallahu anhu, that it was one of the wealthiest from the people of Mecca, that when he was leaving, the mushrikeen, they said, Jittana sa'luka. You came to us as a poor person, now you're leaving rich. So he knew what they wanted. They wanted his wealth. He said, if I give you all of my wealth, will you allow me to leave? They said, yes. And upon approaching Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning the action of Suhaim. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Rabiha bay'u Aba Yahya. Profitable is the trade of Abu Yahya Suhaib. He gave up everything for the sake of Allah. Some others, they left in fear. These people leaving their homes in fear today. If you leave somewhere in fear, you're going to leave everything behind. They left behind their properties, they left behind their wealth, they left behind their businesses. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever was taken from them by force, he wanted to return it to them by raiding the what? The caravans of the mushrikeen on the way to where? To Asham. And what happened when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to meet this caravan? We covered this in the last class. What happened? That caravan escaped the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now in that Badr, in that battle, there was no fighting. And what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do after that? He went back to Medina. But he didn't give up. He went back to Medina because wherever he's going is going to do what? He's going to come back. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went back to Medina with the Sahaba, waiting for it to come back from Asham. And when he comes back with Asham, it's going to be muhammala. It's going to be fully loaded. Because they'll take things from Makkah to sell there and come back with a full caravan. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever is coming back is going to be muhammala, fully loaded. And in truth, when he reached Asham and he was coming back, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received news that they're coming back with a fully loaded caravan. This caravan was so loaded, it had 1,000 camels. 1,000 camels, and in terms of worth, it was a worth of 50,000 dinar, which is a lot of money in those days. And, of course, they had to have security. Guarding this caravan, 40 rajulat, only 40 men. This is ghanima. This is an easy booty for the Prophet and the Sahaba. 40 men, 1,000 camels, and 50,000 dinar. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he started to spread this news amongst the companions. This is going to be an easy ghanima. So now, whilst the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was spreading this news, the Quraysh, the person they put in charge of this caravan, Dahim ibn Wahy al-Arab, from the most intelligent and the sharpest of the Arab, Abu Sufyan, was a mushrik at that time. Abu Sufyan, knowing they're going to have to pass through near Medina, he was extremely cautious. So what he would do, yursilu uyun, he would send eyes for human drones. Before they reach anything, he'll send someone forth to survey the area. Not only would he do this, he himself would ask many questions. So Abu Sufyan, based on his many questioning and sending eyes forward, he knew the Muslims, they were moving, they were up to something. So Abu Sufyan, immediately, he hired a rider to go to Makkah, as fast as he could, to warn the Quraysh, Adriku amwalakum, Muhammad and his companions about to wage a caravan, come and save your wealth. At the same time, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was preparing the Sahaba. And he told them, this is an easy ghanima. You know how many of the Sahaba went out to Badr? They're going to Badr. 313. Some say 314, 317, 300 and how many? 14. Only 2 horses, because they were not going for a battle. Only 2 horses and 70 camels. So they went out to Badr. And the majority of them were from Al-Khazraj. From Al-Khazraj, from the tribe of Khazraj, which was from the tribes of Medina, they numbered all in all 117. From Al-Aus, the other tribe, major tribe of Medina, was 61. How many is left now from the Muhajireen? It was 314. Or two. Jayid? 82. Yeah, there was 117 plus 61. So the amount left now from the Muhajirin was how many? 82. So they went out to meet this caravan, Jayid. Now, they went to Al-Badr. The reason they chose Badr was, you know, when you're traveling on a highway, on a motorway, it's what they call a pit stop, a resting place. Badr, up to this day, is a rest spot, resting spot. Palm trees, houses, wells. So usually when they're coming back, they'll stop there for a day or two, a night, 1 hour. It was a resting spot. So they had to pass through it. And the unique thing about Badr is surrounded by mountains, very high mountains. They only had 3 exit points, northern, southern, and western. And it was easy for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to block all of these points. So the Sahaba went there to block these three, and they will attract them in Al-Badr. So now Abu Sufyan had to pass through Badr. That's the only place he could pass through. So Abu Sufyan, when he got near Badr, not to Badr itself, he set eyes forward and he himself went and asked the people near Badr, have you seen anybody at all? The people of Badr said, we saw 2 men on horses. He said, show me where their horses were. And he went to their horses, where the horses were, and he picked up the dung, rubbed it with his hand, and just by the grains and the roughage of the horse, he said, this, wallahi, min nawa al-yathrib. These grains from the dung of the horse is from the grains of Yathrib, of Medina. Immediately, he took a diversion. He took a diversion they never ever take. He went to Sahil al-Bahar, to the coast, all the way to the west, and avoided Badr completely, all the way towards the west, and avoided Badr completely. So now the Quraysh, they received this news that the caravan is about to be raided. But they didn't know Abu Sufyan took a diversion. So they left the Quraysh. they rushed and took all their weapons. Every single man from not Quraysh, from Mecca, from the tribes of Mecca they left, except for Abu Lahab and Bani Adi. And they numbered, 1,300. And how many of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu? 330. 1,300. And they came out fully loaded with weapons. And they were heading towards where? Towards Badr. And the people, the commander of the people of Mecca was who? Abu Jahl. He was their commander. He was happy this was happening. They started to head. Now, in the same way that Abu Sufyan was sending surveillance forward, the Prophet ﷺ also did counter surveillance. So, in the same way of sending people, the Prophet ﷺ would send people. So, he knew that Abu Sufyan had taken a diversion. So, the Prophet ﷺ also went to Sahil al-Bahr to catch him, also went to the coast to catch him. But by the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Abu Sufyan escaped. It was too late. They reached there, he had escaped. So, now, in the same way he escaped, the Prophet ﷺ also received news that the Quraysh had left with all his forces, all his might to come to fight the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At this point, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he informed the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he would do, wa amruhum shura baynahum, that they would do consult with each other. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he called the Sahaba and he said to them that we didn't come out to fight, we didn't come out for a battle, but Quraysh now, they've left with their full might. So he said to them, Ayyuhan nas ashiru alayya. People, give me the opinion. The first person to stand up, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He said, basically, in short, it's up to you. If you want us to go back to Medina, we'll go back to Medina. If you want us to stay and fight, we'll fight. The second person to stand up was Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. He said the same thing Abu Bakr said. Radiallahu anhu. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept saying, Ayyuhal nas ashiru alayhi, Ayyuhal nas ashiru alayhi. Kept saying it. Until Miqdad stood up. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Miqdad ibn Amr, he stood up. And he said to the Prophet, Miqdad ibn Aws, he stood up. Radiallahu anhu. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that wallahi, we swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, la naqulu laka kama qala banu Israel li Musa, idhhab anta wa rabbuka. فَقَاتِلَ إِنَّهَا هُنَا قَاعِدُونَ. We'll never say to you, as the Jews said to Moses, that go, you and your Lord go and fight. We sit here and wait. He said, we're going to say to you, اذهب, go, you and your Lord and fight. إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّا مَعَكَ مُقَاتِلُونَ. We're going to go and fight with you. This is enough, subhanAllah. Look at the sacrifice, Sahaba radiallahu anhu. This is an important point here, that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu, for people who are confused, when you bump into people of innovation, people that have gone astray, say, I don't know how to debate with them. Number one, if you don't have knowledge, you should debate with those people that insult the companions of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, any other people. But one point you can always ask them on is, who are the ones that fought with Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? What are the ones that sacrificed for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Who was the one that conquered what we see now from the Muslim land, other than these companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Just ask him, where are the graves of the Sahaba? There's an area called Az-Zubara. This area called Zubara is named after who? Zubayr ibn Awwam, because his grave is there. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, who hosted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he entered Medina. Where is the grave of Abu Ayyub al-Ansari? In Istanbul. Imagine, from Medina to Istanbul. Even some of the graves of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, where? In as far as China. And these people that insult the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they've not even opened a hand span, not even 1 centimeter of land. These are the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That subhanAllah, look at the sacrifice, that although they knew they outnumbered them more than 3 times, they're ready to fight. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he continued to ask, Ashiru alayhi. Nobody understood, why are you asking the same thing again and again? The only person that understood was who? Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh. He understood what the Prophet ﷺ meant. That he meant who? The Ansar. That, give me your opinion. You want to see what they want. Why? Because in Bay'ah al-Aqaba al-Thaniya, part of that Bay'ah was what? Protection. Where? In Medina. Not outside Medina. If the Mushrikeen attack Medina, will protect you. But outside Medina, no. And there's nobody that fulfilled his contract, his promises and covenant more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he knew they didn't have to do it. So he said, Ashiru alayhi. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh understood straight away. And he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, La'allaka, maybe you mean us, meaning the Ansar. He said, Walladhi ba'athaka bilhaq. I'm speaking now, he said, on behalf of all of the Ansar. By the one who sent you with the truth. We are not going to leave you to fight these people alone. He said, we'll never leave you to fight them alone. He said, not a single arrow will hit you until it's passed through our chest. SubhanAllah. He said, no harm is going to come to you. And now they're on Sahil al-Bahar. He said, you see the sea? If you tell us to go into it with you, we're going into it, into battle. He said, وَإِنَّ لَصَبْرٌ. And we're extremely patient fil harb. وَصِدْقٌ فِي الْلِقَاء. And when it comes to battle, we're very truthful. He said, لَعَلَّ اللَّهُ. And trust me, Allah is going to see, show you something from us that will make you please. At this point, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the Prophet sallam, سِرْ عَلَى بَرَكَةِ اللَّهِ. Continue upon the blessing of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to them, سِيرُوا. Continue, you likewise, upon the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَبْشِرُوا. And I give you glad tidings. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ وَعَدَنِي بِإِحْدَى طَائِفَتَيْنِ. Allah has promised me one or two things. Either this booty or victory in war. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَاللَّهِ كَأَنَّنِي أَنْظُرْ إِلَى صَرْعِي الْقَوْمِ. I could see the corpses of these people all over the place. As I'm speaking to you, I could see their corpses. Abu Jahl is going to be killed. Umayyah ibn Khalaf is going to be killed. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is informing them on this. As for the Quraysh, they were making their way. When the mushrikeen, they reach the point Manfad or Udwa al-Qaswa, the southern entry point into al-Badr. Before reaching there, news came to them. Abu Sufyan sent another rider to them that, khalas, go back home, we're safe. Your goods are safe, come back to Mecca. Now who's the commander? Abu Jahl. He said, wallahi la narja abada. We're never going to go back. Because look, 330, they've not come out for war. We're 1,300. He said, la narja abada. We're not going to go back. And this was the maqal, the statement of Abu Jahl. He said, wallahi la narja. Hatta na'ti badran wa nuqimu fihi thalatha. Aw nuqimu fiha thalathan. We're not going to go back until we reach Badr. When we get to Badr, we're going to spend three lovely nights in Badr. وَتُنْحَرْ الْجُزُورِ. And in celebration of the party, this is a walkover, we're going to slaughter camels. وَتُشْرَبُ الْخَمَرُ الْخُمُورِ. Much alcohol is going to be drunk. وَتُغَنِّي. And these maids or these dancing women are going to dance for us. So it's a party, it's a disco for Abu Jahl. That we're not going to go back. Now, one of the mushrikeen at that time, a man by Aknas ibn Shurayb al-Thaqafi, who was a tribal leader of Az-Zuhra. He said to Abu Jahl, khalas, let's go back. And he's an old man, Abu Jahl. He said, this person has been affected in his brain by dementia. He's an old man, don't listen to him. So Aknas ibn Shurayb, he took his people back with him. 300. So how many remains now? 1,000. It's still a walkover. So Abu Jahl decided they're still going to continue. So they continue until they reach the southern entry point into Al-Badr. And the Muslims reached on the same night from where? Udwa al-Dunya, from the northern part. Or the entry point from Medina. So they both reached at the same time. So when the Muslims reached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he set up a camp. And the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they built a tent for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is how the Muslim GHQ, General Headquarter, or the Muslim Command Center of War should be. The purpose of this tent that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they built for him was, he spent it in salah, in dua, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory, in humility and servitude. And when they stopped there, one of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, Hubab, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hubab ibn Mundir, and he said, look, this is not a good place to stop. But rather, we should continue forward. This is the Prophet ﷺ receiving wahi from Allah Azza wa Jal, but yet he took the opinions of his companions. He said to him, we should go forward, and what we should do, they're going to enter from the southern part. Let's go as far as we can to where we come across the nearest well to them. Because if they're coming from Mecca, whatever they brought is going to run out in terms of water. And they expect it anyway, they're going to get water. Where can Badr? Let's block all their water and fill it with sand. So when we retreat in a battle, we could drink, they could not drink. So when they reach that point and they find no water there, they're going to have to move forward. And today, military experts and tacticians, they say 50% of victory is to force your enemy into where you want him to fight him. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, if they have no water there, if you look at the history of the Sahaba, the battle Khalid bin Walid, all the battles, they always force their enemy in a certain position. So they force them into a position that they have to be in that position. So the Prophet sallallahu, he proceeded further. They blocked their wells and they retreated back. And then they built another command center for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When they built this command center for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it was here that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to plan the battle tactically. That this person will be in this position, that person in this position, the archers will be there, these people will be there. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to plan the battle tactically. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam started to show them physically where they were. This is this person going to die here. This person going to be slaughtered here. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he started again to spend the rest of the night in dua, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory and in servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On that particular night, Laylatul Badr, the night of Badr, it rained. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they said, we've never had a better sleep than that night, subhanAllah. That you know the next morning, this could be your last night in this dunya. You're going to die tomorrow. And the wars in those days, subhanAllah, swords, arrows, face to face, and they slept very peacefully. Because Shahada was more beloved to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that incident in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِذْ يُغَاشِكُمُ النُّعَاسِ أَمَنَةً مِّنْهُ. Allah Ta'ala covered you with slumberness. They slept like babies. As a وَأَمَنَةً, serenity from Allah Subh'anaHu Wa Ta'ala. وَيُنَزِّي عَلَيْكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِّرُكُمْ بِهِ وَيُذْهِبُ عَنْكُمْ رِجْسَ الشَّيْطَانِ. And He set down from the heavens water upon you, لِيُطَهِّرُكُمْ بِهِ, to purify you and remove from you the filth of shaitan. وَلِيَرْبِطْ عَلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ, and to make your hearts become firm. وَيُثَبِّتْ بِهِ الْأَقْدَامِ, and He kept your feet firm on the ground. This water that was sakina for the Sahaba was calamity for the mushrikeen. They were falling everywhere, it was muddy, they hated it, the worst night of their lives. And then the next day, Yawm Jum'ah, like today, the day of Jum'ah, the 17th of Ramadan, the battle of Badr, it began. The 17th of Ramadan, Yawm Jum'ah. Next week, bi'ithnillahi ta'ala, we're going to the battle of Badr, bi'ithnillahi ta'ala. Subhanakallah, bihamdika, shahadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka.